Revolutionary salutations to the people of Zimbabwe. Comradely salutations to the people of Africa. I greet you all in the name of active solidarity. Comrades, my name is Ncube, Mlambo, a revolutionary intellectual. Today, I'm on the tete-a-tete to cross-pollinate ideas on the state of the economy and broadly speaking on the politics of the motherland. I'm joined by Comrade Treasure Basopo, a development economist, a former student leader, a revolutionary par excellence. Comrade Basopo, welcome to the show.
Thank you very much, Comrade Brother Ncube, Mlambo, for giving me this a unique opportunity. Revolutionary greetings to the people of Zimbabwe. Revolutionary greetings to all those who are listening and watching this video. My name is Comrade Treasure Basopo. As a concerned and bona fide citizen of the Republic of Zimbabwe, as a favored and flavored African, I'm greatly excited to have this historic opportunity, Brother Mlambo, to share and cross-pollinate ideas on this prestigious platform called the Tete-a-Tete with regards to what is transpiring in this 390,757 square kilometer tipo-shaped land called Zimbabwe.
Thank you very much, Comrade Basopo. So fellow Zimbabweans, fellow Africans, today we are going to discuss the state of the economy in our country. How is the economy? How is the economy performing? So Brother Basopo, as a development economist, is going to assist us and tell us more around the issues to do with budget surpluses.
Oh, yes.
And tell us more to issues around to do with economic inequality.
Yeah.
Tell us more around the issues to do with the economic instability that we're witnessing against the background of a state president and a finance minister who are bragging, and regime apologists who are bragging that the RTGS dollar, the only currency in the world with the longest name, is the most stable currency in SADC. So, Comrade Basopo, I want to come to the issue of surpluses. Zimra is saying that it recorded surpluses. Mthuli Ncube is saying that he has recorded surpluses. The government is saying it has recorded surpluses. What is your general comment? Do we really have a surplus? What is the economic status of our country?
Well, thank you very much for making this, for noting this actually, what these government officials they are saying with regards to these surpluses. I think the first thing that we need to understand, Brother Ncube, before we delve into the context of the Zimbabwean context, is to look at what really constitutes development. We're talking of development economists. I think if you look at the recent research by the International Monetary Fund, where they really reversed what is called Reaganomics, the economics Ronald Reagan, who believed in the trickle-down effect, where they said if you want an economy to develop, if you want the gross domestic product to grow, you need to empower the bottom, the most bottom parts of the society than the uppermost. Because, for instance, according to their regression, they said a 1% increase in the incomes of the 20% of the bottom population will result in a 0.038 percentage points in terms of economic growth, that is GDP. But the same 1% increase in the incomes of the 20% uppermost of the society will actually result in a depreciation or in a fall of GDP by 0.08%. So looking into the Mthuli Ncube's economics, Mthuli Ncube's statements, where they are saying they have a surplus. Look, Zimra is celebrating surplus. They actually managed to get a surplus of more than 41.5% in terms of their anticipated variance.
Revenue,
so it's
collection.
positive variance. They recorded about 2.259 million that they managed to get versus what they're expecting, 1.455 million. But if you look at this, the chairman,
the commissioner general,
the chairman of Zimra, he is saying that most of this money that led into the surplus is coming from the intermediate tax, you know, that one which is on transactions, and also of course on excise duty. But if you look at the other things, like they had a negative variance on things like mining royalties. So it means that the government is celebrating surplus that is coming from taxes rather than from
strategic sectors of the economy like mining. So it means mining companies, sorry to cut you, mining companies are evading taxation.
Basically,
because of special economic zones, there's a Chinese company, thank you for bringing issues with mining royalties. There's a Chinese company, I think it's mining chrome or some other mineral in the Midlands province. So they got a special economic zone status. They can mine for the next 12 years without paying any taxes to the state, without paying any mining royalties to Zimra, as you are saying. So I just wanted to make to allude that indeed you are saying the truth, that people as well should know that they are mining companies which are not paying taxes, but the surplus that Zimra is celebrating, for example, is the result of taxing the poor, which is regressive. And you made allusion to Brother Basopo, the IMF report, I also read it, around the failures of Reaganomics. They borrowed from Ronald Reagan, the former president of the United States, and to some extent Margaret Thatcher also believed in free market economics. trickle-down economics by its very nature, it doesn't work. So you are talking about GDP indicators, but I now want you to come in, Brother Basopo, tell us more. You are discussing the quantitative aspect of economic growth, but the qualitative aspect of that growth. So if Mthuli is saying he has recorded $500 million surpluses, $800 million surpluses, what is that the situation on the ground in terms of the material conditions of the people? Prices are going up, but incomes are being eroded. Social services are continuing to deteriorate. Doctors do not have medicines to use in hospitals and equipment. What is your comment? What are your points with regards to this misnomer in our economy?
This is a basic misnomer. You know why they are saying, or they end up saying, we have surpluses? They are persisting with the Rhodesian system of extraction. What Darren S. McGlue and James A. Robinson in their book, Why Nations Fail, what they say, extractive absolutist institutions, which are not inclusionary. So these guys, they are extracting money from the poor of the poorest. That is why you see, okay, friend, they're saying we have a surplus. But like you're saying, the basic living conditions, right now, as we speak, there is no energy in this country. Starting from fuel, energy, petrol, and diesel, gas, not to mention electricity itself. They are saying we are on phase two where people are not going to be accessing electricity for 15 hours of the 24 hours per day. So when a government is failing to provide things like those basics. We've always been talking of water. There is no water in Harare, the biggest city, the capital city. There's no food for the people. I think you're always saying that right now there is a deficiency, if not mistaken, of about 1.4 million tons deficiency of maize alone.
Metric tons.
Before you talk of the cereal for bread.
Yes.
So if you don't have food but you celebrate a surplus, you don't have medicine but you celebrate a surplus, then there is no madness that surpasses that.
Thank you, Brother Basopo. So Mthuli Ncube is a professor of economics and finance, we are told.
Yeah.
Mthuli Ncube went to the University of Oxford.
Yeah.
Mthuli Ncube taught at the University of Cambridge in the UK.
Yeah.
Mthuli Ncube, in short, worked for the Africa Development Bank. He worked for top financial institutions in the world. But Mthuli Ncube is proving one point, that it is one thing to be educated. It is also another thing to be wise.
Yeah.
It is one thing to possess academic certificates and write books.
Of course.
But it is also another thing to understand the political economy of a country. So Mthuli Ncube does not understand the political economy of Zimbabwe.
Is a disgrace.
Mthuli Ncube does not understand the realities in Muzokomba, the realities in Uzumba. Mthuli Ncube is obsessed with the GDP indicators or economic growth indicators as prescribed by the Washington Consensus institutions or Bretton Woods institutions like the World Bank and the IMF.
Yeah.
But those indicators are not reflective of what is on the ground.
Yeah.
So the New Zealand Prime Minister, Brother Basopo, is now saying her budget, 2019-2020 budget, is not going to focus on economic growth. Her budget is going to focus on the well-being of citizens. So she's saying she's going to devote $200 million to fund victims of domestic violence, to rehabilitate drug abusers.
That's human development.
To make, human development indicators. And that makes New Zealand one of the top five countries in the human development indicators, as written by the United Nations Development Programme. So, Brother Basopo, Mthuli Ncube should take a leaf from the New Zealand system. Mthuli Ncube should take a leaf from the Scandinavian model, Norway, Sweden, Singapore, Finland, who focus on improving the housing standards of their people, the decent work standards of their people, the material conditions of their people, not being upset saying the TSP is bearing fruit, the Transitional Stabilization Program is bearing fruit, when he's now saying that basic prices will be down next month in July. But he's forgetting that in January, he said by April 2019, the price of basic goods will be down. So Mthuli Ncube has been caught in flagrant delicto. He's failing to
remember the World Bank actually recently predicted, remember, said last week, they said Zimbabwe by the end of this year will be having an inflation at double digit. Of course, we already know that we are above that. But they've said we are within the context of countries like Sudan, Nigeria, countries which are rampantly,
Yemen,
Sierra Leone,
Syria.
Exactly. Affected. So Mthuli Ncube, I think, like, is a disgrace to the whole
Washington Consensus, the Bretton Woods.
This is where he went.
Oxford.
Is a disgrace to the whole Oxford alumni. The way he's exhibiting and executing his duties.
And
you can't imagine, he's an author of a book
that is being used in universities.
Where he said, lessons from Zimbabwe.
Which lessons?
Lessons of failure.
Yes.
So that's why we have reached as a people and as a country. But I think it is important for us at this moment in time to understand, Brother Mlambo, that, of course, this is economics, but also the politics.
Yes.
I always like to learn from people like Rosa Parks.
Yes.
You know, the struggle that she fought when she denied to rise when she was in a bus for a white person for a seat. Where there was a revolution from the 1st of December to the 20th of December, the next following year, which is 1956, after 1955. I also like
a year of revolutionary
a year of revolutionary election, challenging a system. I remember the issue of Mohamed Bouazizi on the 17th of December 2010, where he self-immolated in public because he had been abused as a street vendor. So I think in this context, you know, we are celebrating, we're in a week of, we're in a week
June 16th, the Sharpeville massacre, you the Soweto uprising. So Brother Basopo, as you are mentioning June 16th, I understand the Democratic Party, the Democratic movement in this country, through its youth assembly, has been conducting various activities around June 16th, somewhere in Cheche, somewhere in Harare, somewhere in Matebele, somewhere in Bedbridge.
Yes.
I think they are now galvanizing the youth around a clear program of action, which we do not know at this particular juncture.
Yeah, of course.
Brother Basopo, you talk about the politics. So at the end of the day, the issues around chlorinating the politics and the issue of legitimacy now comes back. The one occupying number one Chancellor Avenue does not have the trust of the people. He signed recently the tripartite negotiating forum, and it's now enacted the bill with this. I say thumbs up to that move. We on the tete-a-tete, we've always been saying that social dialogue and renegotiating of the social contract is paramount. So I say thumbs up to the Zimbabwe Congress of Trade Unions and the government and business for signing the tripartite negotiating forum. But number one, we now wait to see the implementation. Are they going to consult labor? Are they going to consult all social partners? For Zimbabwe to be a democratic developmental state, it must be anchored on consensus building.
No doubt.
A consensus state. No doubt. Brother Basopo, I want you to come in, you know, and give us your, if there are final parting shots, if there are other vignettes that you want to share with the people of Zimbabwe before we conclude this.
The one who is at the top of this country, President Emmerson Mnangagwa, of course, deputized by one of the most uninspiring deputies ever to exist in the history of deputy presidents. I listened to him when he was talking of introducing currency, when he said,
on capital, we
are going to bring some fundamentals, you know, within the next 6 months. And what are the fundamentals he mentioned? He meant the issue of public confidence. He meant the issue to do with doing away with the corruption. You remember President Robert Mugabe when he said there are people who are swindling us who swindled us 15 billion.
Yes.
But Mugabe never arrested any swindler nor recovered any swindled dollar.
Yes.
This one, when he came in and said, I want to arrest criminals surrounding the president.
He
has never arrested a swindler nor recovered any swindled dollar.
Yes. So actually, there was a list of externalizers, but today we don't know about the money. Whether the money was recovered, there's no transparency.
Yeah, exactly. Yes. And so how can't expect them to do something the next 6 months that they failed to do over the past
since they came in November.
If you were to be generous.
Yeah, say November 2017.
So what you need to do in this country, for talking of public confidence, the things that you need to do in this country if you are to move forward is to restore macroeconomic stability as a precondition
fiscal
for economic recovery.
Yes.
It's very important. If you are to restore macroeconomic stability, also need to make sure, I think, every successful politician, every successful minister must be able to understand the widely accepted results of 1995 economic results after a research by Raymond Remy, who said private investment is grossly it's negatively affected and significantly affected by macroeconomic instability and uncertainty.
Lack of fiscal discipline.
And the 2000 results of Cray, they are clear that if you are to go, if economy is to grow and investment is to increase and productivity should be there, that those things they are positively correlated to macroeconomic stability. So it's important to define in this Zimbabwean context what are the things that qualify or that are able to define what macroeconomic stability is, which is of course our politics we're talking of right now. People are haywire, prophets are running away, some are afraid of abductions and all those things. So our politics is very wrong.
Toxic,
our economics is all wrong.
Affected.
So we need stability in these sectors. That's
thank you very much, Comrade Basso. Zimbabwe is not ready for a currency. That's what you're trying to tell the people of Zimbabwe.
Absolutely.
Because the fundamentals of confidence, currency is a function of confidence.
In trust.
In trust. Yes, productivity comes second. But the most fundamental thing is trust. The moment a people trust a government, the moment a people trust a central government, a central bank, the moment a people trust a finance minister, the moment a people trust a president, the moment a people trust a government, naturally and inevitably, society will flow. So the most important factor that you raised, that we are not ready for a currency.
We are not.
We will only be ready for a currency when the legitimacy question has been solved.
When
that's Nelson Jamisa, Emmerson Mnangagwa, a labor, the ZCTU, students under Zinasu, peasants like us, come on the same table, negotiate and charter a way forward, and how we re-democratize Zimbabwe, how we make sure that necessary political and institutional reforms are done so that the next election won't be highly contested, but it will produce policy outcome reflective of the collective aspirations of the people. Mm-hmm. But I also want to say that they are saying this currency is the strongest in SADC, mm-hmm. but the material conditions, as we always say, mm-hmm. are not reflective of their utterances. Mm-hmm. It's a clear sign mm-hmm. that we are celebrating that which does not exist.
Yeah.
Brother Basopo, I want you to give your final parting shots mm. as we conclude this
tete-a-tete. Issue of the currency, remember, this is not the first introduction mm. or the first passion to introduce a currency. Mm. Remember, in 2009, we introduced 5 currencies initially, mm. then we added 4. Mm. We had 9 currencies. Mm. In 2016, we added some other currencies. Bond. Recently, we had. So I think we have more than 10 recognized legitimate currencies in this country.
Basket
so these people, it's not just a question of currencies. Mm. These people must get things
fundamentally right.
Fundamentally right. Mm. Must stop being overzealous, must stop. Running against citizens mm. must stop buying ammunition and yes. armory when it is not necessary. Please let us give a priority. Don't to. Suffer from a disease that is called prioritizes, mm. where they don't even know what to do things first mm. and stuff like that. Mm. So, revolutionary greetings once again, fellow comrades. Please enjoy this tete-a-tete. Mm. Aluta continua. The struggle in Zimbabwe is our struggle. Le mapambano yanaendelea. Zimbabwe faradesa. Moi, comrades, moi.
Thank you very much, Comrade Basopo. Thank you very much to our viewers and the majority of our people in the African continent who follow the tete a tete. Comrades, I would like to say rest in revolutionary power. Mm. Comrade Wimbai Changirai Java, rest in revolutionary power. The wife of Apostle Chiwenga and other victims were involved in a car accident. Mm. We have lost gallant daughters mm. and the son of the Republic. Mm. We also wish Apostle TF Chiwenga a speedy recovery as he is in hospital. Yeah. We also wish Advocate Tabani Mpofu a speedy recovery. We understand he was involved in a car accident in Marsh Central on Saturday after attending a church event. Mm. We are worried by the state of our roads. Mm. We are worried by the accidents that are perennially happening in our context enemies of the state. No one is an enemy of the state. If Apostle Chiwenga disagrees with you, it's because he has a democratic right to disagree. If Tabadi Mpofu represents Nelson Chamisa, it means Chamisa has a right to legal representation as codified in Chapter 4 of the Constitution of Zimbabwe. No one, you don't become an enemy of the state, or you don't become less patriotic by opposing that which you do not see fit as a governance model for your country. It shows love when one criticizes the government because they want the state to improve, the material conditions of the people to improve. So, fellow Zimbabweans, fellow Africans, I urge you to like our Facebook page, Tete a Tete. Just search Tete a Tete on Facebook.
Shaping politics.
Mm-hmm. Like our Facebook page. Let's continue the conversations. We'll create a Twitter account very soon. And we are moving. We are moving and we're embracing the technological era because we are young people who are committed to the democratization for our struggle. Mm-hmm. So I say, Aluta continue. Long live the fight for a democratic egalitarian Zimbabwe. Long live. Long live the fight for democracy. Long live Comrade Obed Masarori, the leader of the Amalgamated Rural Teachers Union of Zimbabwe. Long live Stabile Dewa. Long live Rita Nyampinga and all the victims of state brutality.
Long live Nelson Chamisa.
Long live Wamba Diawamba. Long live Great Zimbabwe. Mm. I thank you.